Hello, everyone, and welcome to Hens All Access. You're watching Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. I'm Scott Klatzkin here with head coach Dave Brock. We're here to talk about the Jacksonville game and get you ready for the next one against Lafayette. Coach, a 20-14 loss against Jacksonville on Friday. Obviously, a disappointing game. Where was the biggest disappointment in that first contest against the Dolphins?
Well, anytime you don't play well enough to win, you're frustrated. I think... The expectations that the players had, the coaches had, you know, coming out of training camp were high, and we felt like we would play much better than we did, not only offensively but as a team. And, we need to get those things fixed as we work towards playing Lafayette at 6 o'clock on Saturday night.
Offensively, the team didn't seem like they were able to get things going in the second half. In the first half, you're able to sustain some drives, get down into the red zone a few times, but weren't able to capitalize on those opportunities. Is that part of the frustration on offense, just not being able to punch it in when you get close?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, we had an opportunity, first drive of the game, we're down there. We have a penalty called against us that knocks us out, and we end up on a short field punt. Drove the ball down the next series and ended up fumbling it on the 6-yard line, which is really frustrating because we need to punch it in there. We need to get some points, build some momentum, and climb back into the game and make it a 7-7 game. A couple drives later, we only had 4 in the first half. We were able to drive it, 10, 11 plays, 80 yards for a touchdown. And you felt, going in at halftime that we had established a couple drives, we had made a couple plays, and we felt like with a couple things that we were going to do at halftime, we'd come out and be able to play well in the second half, which we certainly didn't do. And again, it was collective. It wasn't just the quarterback. It was, we didn't run the ball as well as we'd like to. We didn't block as well as we'd like to. The perimeter didn't play as well, and we didn't coach it as well. So, we have to figure out a way to make sure that we get done what we need to get done offensively this Saturday against Lafayette so that we don't have a reoccurring problem.
Back to the offense, 2 quarterbacks rotated in that first game. You said you'd like to go with 1 quarterback at least for the second game and have that quarterback be able to have the opportunity to show that it's theirs to be the starter. There weren't many opportunities for either quarterback to really excel or neither one necessarily took a lead. So how will you evaluate and choose who will be that starting quarterback on Saturday?
Well, a little bit of it is carryover from training camp and how I feel. I'm looking to find out if one of these guys can play, and my comfort level, is higher with one than the other. And I need to find out which guy can do it. So as we go along the season, we're able to put ourselves in a position to have a guy that's going to go out there and people can rally around him and do those types of things. But you still need 2 guys. The reality is, let's say we didn't have any rotation, anything going on, 3rd or 4th play of the game, bang, the helmet pops off, our backup quarterback's in the game. With or without a rotation, if God forbid that helmet coming off is a concussion, then the other guy goes the whole game. The nuts and bolts of the challenges that exist don't change. I need to figure out for the program and for the offense's sake, what direction we're going to go the rest of the year and see whether or not the decision we make this week is correct.
Defensively, a lot of young guys out there playing for the first time. Didn't look like they were playing for the first time. I thought the defense played very well against Jacksonville. Opening drive, allowed a touchdown, and then the rest of the game really buckled down. A low percentage for Jacksonville on 3rd down conversions and did not allow another touchdown for the rest of the night. You had to be pleased, I would think, with the way your defense went out there and played.
Yeah, again, other than the first drive, I think there was a little bit of anxiety, a little bit of nervousness and that type of stuff. But I think they got it out of their system pretty quick. And we played an awful lot of people. 21 guys played in the game, and I thought they played really hard. I thought they created a lot of disruption. I thought they played really well. We tackled better than we've tackled in a long time. And again, we didn't get the result we wanted. You look at our focal points for the year, and 2 of the 3, we were pretty good. And the third, taking the football away and creating turnovers, we didn't do a good enough job. Got one at the end, which gave us a chance at least to try to get back into the game. But the rest of the game, we weren't able to get the ball out or be ball disruptive. And we need to be able to do that, as the season wears on, because we're going to need extra opportunities offensively, and we're going to need to create them for our offense so that, again, we can help ourselves get better on that side of the ball.
How about some of those young guys? I thought Nasir Adderley started and made some great tackles. I thought Ray Jones was very active, almost had a score that was called back, but broke up a pass as well. Tell me a little bit of your thoughts on the freshmen that got out there.
Well, they all did a good job, really. I mean, I wouldn't want to single one out over the other. I think Buck, obviously, because he's a local guy and he commands a little more attention probably because he's so well-known locally. But Nas played great. Tenney did a great job in his 16, 20 snaps, whatever it was. Casey Hinton did a great job. Jay played at linebacker, Jason Thompson, and Cam Kitchen played at defensive end. Again, we played 21 guys in the game on defense, and my guess is we'll play more Saturday night and continue to roll fresh bodies at people, and we got to continue to be disruptive and sack the quarterback and get him off his spot and stop the run, and if we can do those things, then we'll have a chance to be the team we want to be.
And then going from young to old, what a week David Tinsley had. He was named as the solo captain for the 2015 season and then gets two sacks in his first game. Is that what he looks like when he's healthy? It's been a long time since we've seen David Tinsley play healthy, but what a start to the season.
Yeah, I was happy for David. You know, he works so hard. He comes back. He graduates from college. He makes a commitment to come back and get his MBA. And you love it when a story works out well. And he played really, really hard. I mean, the sacks are obviously the most notable thing, but you know, he was really a disruptive player in the run game and a fierce leader for us, you know, in terms of taking those young guys on defense under their wing and talking to them and making sure that those kids were playing with a lot of fire and passion. He's done a great job. So I look for him to continue to not only do a great job as the captain, but continue to be a really productive player on defense.
And then wrapping things up on the Jacksonville game, special teams-wise, some really good returns. Wes Hills was back. We saw Ray Jones return a kickoff that set up that final drive. Your thoughts on how the team did on special teams?
Well, I thought we did well. A couple things that we certainly need to clean up. You know, our kick return game was outstanding, and kick coverage was outstanding. You know, we knocked it down inside the 20 both times. We did a really good job in the return game and set up some solid field position for the offense. Punting wise, you know, we had a missed tackle issue twice. Coverage was pretty good. We missed a tackle. We got to get that cleaned up. We got to punt the ball a little bit better. And then our punt return game, that kid did a good job. You know, he hit a couple bad punts with great results. And we really didn't have a chance to field three of them. And then we muffed one. So we got to clean that up and do a better job in the return game and try to turn that into a positive. Rags did a good job kicking the football. Kev did a good job on kickoffs. So the procedural stuff in the kicking game was pretty solid.
Just be thankful you don't have Jimmy Smith out there punting the football for you, because we're gonna take a break.
Thank God.
When we come back, Eric Enderson is gonna teach our very own Jimmy Smith how to punt. I can't wait to see this one. We'll be back in a moment on Hens All Access.
In my blood, with every breath in my lungs, won't stop until I'm phenomenal. No. However long it takes, I'll go to whatever lengths. It's gonna make me a monster, though. But I'm never the same.
Stay connected with the Blue Hens on all social media outlets. Follow at UD Blue Hens on Twitter for score updates, news, and everything Delaware sports. Check out at Hens All Access to see what it takes behind the scenes to bring you Delaware athletics. Interact with the University of Delaware Fightin' Blue Hens on Facebook to get to know the athletes and hear about events offered to Blue Hens fans. And take a look at UD Blue Hens on Instagram for game times, game finals, along with throwbacks of old Hens and promos for future Hens.
Welcome back to Under the Lights. I'm Jimmy Smith here with All-American punter Eric Enderson. And Eric's going to teach me how to punt here. I've never done it. I never played a snap of football. I've kind of always really been enamored with how the punting thing works. When did you get into punting? And why did you get into punting? Because it doesn't seem like anybody wants to be the punter.
They always try to make me play goalkeeper when I played soccer back when I was younger. And that's kind of what made me start punting. But I really actually didn't start punting until I came here my freshman year. That's actually the first time I actually focused on punting and really tried to be good at it, even though I wasn't at first. But that's the first time I actually started punting. So now I'm going on my fourth year of punting. So.
Well, Eric's going to, again, teach me how to punt here, but I want to go through your pregame routine. And one of my favorite things is a stretch you do with Kevin. I'm 29. This is not one. You've got to go more than I do. This is awful. Like, I can't even get my legs on the ground. Look how much my legs are going up. I can't even talk to you right now. This hurts. I mean, I know Coach Brock said this in the first show. He said he hates seeing you on the field. And I, I agree. I hate seeing you on the field, but I love seeing you on the field. How's that feel?
I like to think people like me like watching me out on the field. I know my mom does. So I guess that's really all that matters at the end of the day. But it's just the fact that even though they don't like seeing me on the field, they know that I'll get the job done. So it is a positive aspect of the game, even in a bad circumstance. And that's pretty cool to have, I guess, as a punter. I think that's what every punter wants. So it's kind of positive. It's positive for me.
Well, I like seeing you only because you kicked the ball far, and that's the goal. All right, so here's the curveball I'm going to throw you. So your biggest accomplishment last year was that touchdown at Albany, right?
Yeah.
Would you say?
Yeah, probably.
All right, so the thing I don't like about that, though, it's your only collegiate touchdown so far. Mm-hmm. Maybe you'll score another one. Your celebration was kind of weak. So I want to give you a chance. We're going to go right over here. I want to give you a chance to redeem yourself.
Ooh.
Okay?
All right. Through.
So he swings through, and now,
I take it.
Now you're gone.
And I'm out.
All right, now relive the moment.
I probably would have came right here, come running. I still would have had to go into the corner because I couldn't have made the speed. And I definitely would have dove something like that. And then maybe like came up and did like a ball flip and got a 15-yard penalty and made him kick off 15 yards because who knows if I'll ever score again. So what I do, I take two steps to kick, so my left foot's out in front since I'm right-footed. And then I'm going to catch it, and then I'm going to take my first step with my right.
Okay.
And then I'm going to let go with this. While I'm stepping with my left, you got to make sure the ball is aligned with the outside of your hip, and you want the ball straight.
Okay.
So you don't want it turned in like this.
Yep.
You want it straight, and then you want a perfect drop. And that's when you're going to swing your leg through.
Okay.
You don't want to throw, and also, you don't want to throw the ball out. You don't want to, like, push it like that. Because that's when it'll hit your toe.
All right, let's do it in real time for you.
All right, let's see. Let's see how this goes.
Terrible snap. Okay.
Not bad.
That was pretty good. All right, I'm going to catch.
Catch, step. That's not bad.
That's not awful, right?
That's not bad.
I actually wasn't thinking at all about what I was doing.
Yeah, the steps weren't too great. The drop was eh.
Well, I was in a big hurry. Oh, I kicked the ground. Did you see I kicked the ground?
I did. All right, I'm going to make some coaching adjustments.
All right.
You have to make sure your arm is fully extended.
Out. Okay.
It has to be all the way out because it's naturally going to lead to your foot. Like, that's natural.
I almost kicked Katie with the camera.
Arm extended.
Woo, I almost hit the GoPro.
That's not bad.
No, that was 20 yards, Enderson.
That's probably a 4-second hang time.
That's helpful, though, right?
That's pretty good. I think that's what Coach Allen wants.
Okay. I'll let him know. That's good.
That's not bad at all.
What was that? I'm at the 10 that hit the 50? Hit the 45?
Yeah.
All right.
So that's what, 25 yards? Not bad at all.
And I gave my return team no chance to get down there. And it's probably a touchdown.
That's a 35-yard net average.
Back the GoPro up. I want him to kick it over it. You can get over that, right?
Of course.
We'll find out. All right, here we go. That was high. Oh, yeah. That's really good. All right, All-American punter Eric Enderson, that is not as easy as it looks. How did you get into punting again? Like, did you play soccer?
Yeah, I did back in high school, and I like to think that I could still go over there and play with the UD men's soccer team, but I think they're pretty good
this year.
They're
pretty good.
I
don't think you're in shape.
No, not in shape at all. Just running to the end zone earlier made me tired, and this is the most I've sweat since the season started. So.
Yeah, me too. I don't normally come out here and kick the ball, but thank you for teaching us, and hopefully we'll see some boomers on Saturday against Lafayette.
That's the plan. Hopefully not too many, so I'm not on the field too
much.
That's
true. It's a love-hate relationship.
If I am, hopefully they'll be good.
All right, well, that's All-American punter Eric Enderson. Thank you to him. I try my best, but I definitely don't have any eligibility left, and it's not for that. So when we come back, head coach Dave Brock and Scott Klatzkin will break down their opponent on Saturday. That's Lafayette when we return here on Under the Lights.
It only only takes one person to save a life.
And you can make a difference. It's painless, it's easy, it takes 15 minutes.
We will make a difference in the future of these people that have these diseases.
Join CAA football for Be the Match Saturday. You too can get in the game and save a life.
It's a chance to save a life. How great is that?
For more information, visit caafootball.com.
You can now watch all Hens All Access content on any of your devices. Whether you're at the store on your phone or on the couch with your iPad or laptop, Hens All Access live and on-demand content is just a touch away. Not only will live games be available on your mobile devices, they'll also be available in high definition. Best of all, you don't even need an app. Just click over to bluehens.com on your device and take the Hens anywhere you go.
Welcome back to Under Lights, driven by Chevy. I'm Scott Klatzkin here once again with head coach Dave Brock. We talked about the opener against Jacksonville. Now let's talk about game number two as Lafayette will come into Delaware Stadium. And really, before we talk about Lafayette coming into town and what they do on offense and defense, as you move forward with such a young group, isn't it more so about what you guys need to take care of and then you'll figure out your opposition?
Yeah, I mean, I think it always is, in terms of certainly when you're a young football team, that's important. But I think that's always the case, no matter where I've coached or where I've been. You know, you have to take care of what you do and how you do it. You have to be true to the style of football you want to play and how you want to play it. And, again, we've had a great week of practice this week. We need to continue to work, and we need to find a way to be 1-0 this week.
Lafayette comes to Delaware Stadium 0-1 in the CAA as they've taken on William & Mary and lost their first game of the year. Did so with a quarterback in Blake Searfoss that certainly very capable at the quarterback position. He's played throughout his career, but the starter, Drew Reed, was suspended for game one. Do you suspect that you'll see Reed back at the quarterback position, and does their offense really change either way?
I don't know that we expect him to play, yeah. I mean, again, coach out down there, he didn't announce the suspension until after the game. I would assume that it was a one-game suspension, and we'll see the normal starting quarterback. I don't know that it changes a ton. They're a very multiple offense. They'll be in multiple sets. They'll be in empty. They do a bunch of different things. They've got a talented running back, a couple good receivers. They suspended three other players as well, didn't name them. A couple guys offensively didn't play. Now, whether it was injury or suspension, I don't know that. But we're anticipating seeing everybody, all hands on deck, when they get to Delaware Stadium. So, we're going to have to do a great job defensively. We're going to have to be able to defend multiple things, tackle in space, much bigger, stronger group up front on the offensive line. They're going to try and pound you a little bit, so that'll be a good match for our defensive line. We're going to play 8-9 guys. So, I feel like we got plenty of firepower in there to match with them. We're going to have to do a great job defensively, no question about it.
Defensively for Lafayette, what will they bring against a quarterback that might be starting for the entire and playing the entire game for the first time for Delaware?
Well, I think you look at them, the strength certainly on the perimeter of the defense. They have two really good players in the secondary. A young guy break a bone in his leg last week in the game. He'll be out. I would anticipate they move their all-conference safety to corner. Big, rangy kid. He's also their punt returner, really a good player. Their other corners, again, a dynamic player on some preseason All-American lists, a kick returner. Dual threat players, very talented on the perimeter. And inside, again, it's rough and tumble football. Big, strong kids. They're going to try and rough you up, try to play physical, thump you. So it'll be a good matchup for our offensive line, our running backs, tight ends. I think it'll be a physical affair up inside. One we're going to have to win to play the style of football we want to play. And then we're going to have to get some shots down the field and make some plays.
Back-to-back games to start the season at Delaware Stadium. I thought the student section was loud, and it was packed at Delaware Stadium week one, that Jalen Randolph touchdown grab right in front of the students. It was very noisy in there. Certainly, we want all the students and fans to come back and support us on Saturday.
Oh, yeah, it was wild. The fans did an incredible job. The students packed the place, and the whole place is jammed in there. You look up in the corner of the stadium, all the students are sitting up there. The players, the program is so appreciative of everything they do. And again, we're hoping that they come back we need another chance to win them over and play a great game and really put them in a position where, they're going to be here all year and supporting the players. And again, we're very, very grateful for everybody who comes out when that place is rocking, it's like no other place in the country.
Absolutely. Another chance to see the Blue Hens on Saturday at 6 o'clock as they host Lafayette. Until then, for head coach Dave Brock, I'm Scott Klatzkin. Thanks for watching, and as always, go Hens.